good. I am good.
In your bench, repping the London talent and ting, you know, it's how we do.
Yeah.
How are you
good
today?
Yeah, I'm good.
It's been a while, isn't it? Look, oh, like I'm just talking over you now. This is just, what am I doing?
It's,
I'm
fine.
Over you. How you doing though? You good? Yeah.
I'm perfect, man. I'm really, really good. Yeah, yeah. Just chilling, relaxing in my house.
Yeah. Yeah, coping with this lockdown, like part two.
Yeah, yeah. To be honest, I was saying to like a couple of my friends, but even me and my wife were saying that we kind of really enjoyed lockdown from the beginning because we didn't want to go into work anyway.
Right.
So working from home is perfect for us because it just means we get to be around our son more. And obviously now he's at school. It's just nice to kind of like live in our house for once.
Enjoy the space, right? Because get up, you know, like you said, you've got a son, take him to school, go work, come back, sort the dinner, chill. You know, there's not really much time. So I feel like this quarantine has definitely kind of made people stop and just even just appreciate like what they have, like your wife, your home, everything, you know, just bring it back. So,
exactly.
Okay, well, thank you so much for joining me today on this platform. This is Talk to Me Black Man. This is a space that is designed to kind of hear what black men really think about a variety of sort of topics and subjects, and just really to kind of get a conversation going on, like a relatable conversation. So just to kick off, I've got three sentences. I would like you to finish the sentences just so people can get like a feel for you. All right. But yeah, cool. Not too much, man. Just calm.
No. Listen, I'm down. I'm here. Right. Yeah.
Okay. So the first sentence is, as a black man, I am.
As a black man, I am, that's deep. As a black man, as a black man, I am here.
Right.
Here. Yeah.
Very much so here.
Present, you know? Yeah. Man.
I feel like that's very kind of Kendrick Lamar. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I see why you say that. But I think you know what I mean by that.
I know what you mean.
Yeah. You know, I'm here to be. You can't not notice me. And,
And that's why I say it's very Kendrick Lamar. And I mean that with all due respect, because he's very much about, I'm here, what I say, how I feel, the whole kind of essence of me as a black individual. Like, I'm here and you're going to take it. Like, you're going to eat it.
Yeah.
I love that. I'm here. Okay. My blackness means.
Whoa. My blackness means everything to me. Yeah, proud of my heritage, proud of my skin color, proud of my history. The good stuff. And my blackness is everything to me, everything. And that's all types of blackness across the world, not just African or Nigerian, you know, the whole thing. Yeah, it's everything.
It's amazing. Like, let's be real. It's amazing. Yeah. The culture's rich. The race is just.
Yeah, come on.
It's a good race.
Yeah. Yeah. Wherever we go, we bring the vibes. And that's what I love. Yeah, I love about being black.
Okay. The final one. The biggest misconception about black men, in my opinion, is.
That we're all dangerous. I think that's the biggest misconception. Me, I will run from a fight in a split second.
That's what killed it.
Don't get twisted. I stand up for myself. That's a, okay. Everyone knows that. I stand up for myself. I won't have it.
Yeah.
However, once the weapons start getting drawn out, I'm gone. Right. It's about choices as well. You don't want to make the wrong choice and then have to be sitting in the bin for like 10, 20 years, you know what I'm saying? Because you made one stupid choice. You decided, let me shoot this guy or stab this one. And, you know, that's 10 years of your life gone. You're just sitting. So, yeah, it's about choices. I'm always making smart choices. But, yeah, we ain't all dangerous. Some of us are nice, you know.
So. A lot of you are nice.
Yeah.
Most of you are nice.
Yeah, exactly.
Even like when you get people that are racist or that are racist by default, and when I say racist by default, like people that are brought up in homes where they're openly exposed to racist talk and stuff like that, that is the narrative that they're fed. Oh, black men are dangerous. Stay away from them. They're killers, they're murderers. They don't look after their children.
Yeah. That's not us.
No. So Babatunde, so you, let's talk about you and, you know, your journey. I know you as a comedian, you know, I've seen you on the comedy circuit, but I also know that you act. And actually you were in a film that it was a British film that I enjoyed, but I felt was underrated, The Naked Poet.
Oh, wow. You saw that?
Yeah, I saw that. That's Jason Barrett's movie, right?
Yeah.
It was very Love Jonesy, you know, that kind of feel. I don't think it got the kind of attention that it deserved. But basically, my point is, I know that you're an actor as well as a comedian, and you write and stuff like that. You've also won a few awards, and you've been kind of, you know, let's say, endorsed by the legend that is Dave Chappelle.
Oh, yeah.
Hold on, did I?
Can I just say something?
Of course.
That is surreal, even for me, because all he said was, hey man, you're funny. And that was enough. He saw my set, came backstage and was just like, you're funny. Like, you know, good on you.
Yeah.
And I, like, even when I saw him, when I got there, because that was the second time I've seen him, but that was the first time I ever met him personally. So I get to the show and, well, basically this is how it went. Kojo must have sent out like a broadcast message and he was just like, hey, Dave Chappelle's got a secret gig tonight at the Backyard Comedy Club. So I just texted him back and I said, okay, cool, I'll be there. He'll be like, be there? You're performing.
Oh, stop.
And I'm like, yeah, I'm freezing. I'm like, oh my God. So I ring up my manager and I'm like, Dave Chappelle's in town. Like, Kojo wants me to perform. It's for this show called The Process, blah, 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 blah. And my manager, she ain't no pushover. She's just like, cool, I want you to do the show, but if they're going to record it, there needs to be a contract.
Right.
So my manager, she comes down and she's talking to everybody. Where's the contract? She sorts me out nicely. They get a contract out for me. She's like, cool, I'm going to look over this. And, you know, she goes off, she does her thing. But then when Dave Chappelle got there, I go back to where he is. And as soon as I saw him, I just froze. And I couldn't say anything. So I don't know whether he thought at the beginning that I was like rude or something.
Mm-hmm.
But imagine Beyonce is someone who you...
Yeah, I know, like the old school Michael Jackson maybe. But...
Okay, Michael Jackson. Yeah, exactly. If, like, you know, rest in peace. But if he was still alive,
yeah,
having to see like your idol, you go backstage and he's right there. It's like, what do I say in this moment? There is not, I can't, even hello, Dave, or...
Not enough.
It's not, like, what the hell? As soon as I saw him, I just froze and I was just like, and I just acted like, okay, he's there, but let me not act like a fanboy, like, right now.
So, I bet you were overthinking it as well. It's like, too much was going on in your head.
Too much, because it's just like, I've watched this guy, I've studied this guy, and he is right there. You're like, right, you're in arm's reach, like, you're there.
It's mad.
Yeah, mess me up. And then when he comes backstage, he's just like, you're funny. Oh, man, I was a mess.
But that's nice, though, Babatunde. That must have really made you feel like, you know what? Given that he's such an idol to you, you know, that must have been a real kind of, not even just a highlight, like, a proper, like, highlight. Like, that's way up there for you.
Because especially with that show that we did, it was funny because he was hosting.
Mm.
It's hard to kind of live up to his level because obviously he's the host on that night particularly. And so everyone was funny, but...
Not as.
So me and Travis J, we got like the biggest reactions.
Nice.
And, you know, other people made the crowd laugh, but me and Trav, we got the biggest reaction. And it was just like, yeah, you know, we felt good because it's just like, all right, we kind of made the crowd laugh as much as he did.
Right.
That says
everything, especially from where you're standing. You know, that's the endorsement you kind of need. That's the confirmation you kind of need. That's amazing. That is crazy to feel endorsed by. Well, it is an endorsement. Like, for him to say that, I'm sure he doesn't say that just to any old buddy.
No, he really don't.
He's quite stush, like, when he's ready. He's a bit stush, isn't it?
I mean, I don't know him personally, but, I mean, it's... as a comedian, you just know who's got it and who has it. You know what I'm saying? You can always.
So what other highlights do you have? Obviously, that's a massive one for you. Are there any other standout moments for you so far?
So far, I think winning the, I recently won the Amuse Moose Comedy Award for new act, even though I'm not a new act, but in terms of on the mainstream comedy circuit, I'm a new act. So winning that was a massive highlight. I won that last year in Edinburgh. That was massive. And then obviously recently, just, you know, being on Gogglebox with Mo, that was, yeah, that's been pretty special. Like the feedback we got was beyond what I thought, you know what I'm saying? Because, yeah.
You two on Gogglebox, I don't care. Like, I know I'm not the only one that's just tuning in to see you guys. It's not even a black thing. It is just, you guys are just relatable.
Yeah.
Reactions, I mean, I love Gogglebox anyway, because I just think it's such a great kind of concept.
Yeah.
So to see you guys on there is just amazing. Obviously, you are a celebrity, but do you feel like a celebrity?
Well, at that point, no, I wasn't. Not really, because you I'm not recognized. Well, I am now, but then I wasn't.
What defines a celebrity? Because people knew you. Okay, you might not have been like A-list, but people knew you. So you were a celebrity, essentially.
To an extent, but I was literally just Mo's friend. On that show, I was Mo's friend at the beginning, but then...
Not anymore.
Towards the end, it was just like, nah, Babatunde, Mo, both of them are like... popular in their own right. Obviously, Mo is, you know, he's gone clear. But because we were, like I said, we were only signed up for 5 episodes at the beginning. But then because of the feedback, they were just like, listen, we're going to put you on the whole thing. And then on top of that, we're going to bring you back for the Stand Up to Cancer special.
Nice.
So that was special in itself, with the fact that, hey, people really, really enjoyed our time, you know, watching TV and providing jokes and all of that. So yeah, that's been the highlight of 2020 for me.
I can imagine. So do you watch it back, like when it airs? Do you sit down and watch it with Ivy?
Oh yeah, because so obviously, because it has to be edited and all of that, so much gets taken out. So there's times where me and Mo, like, we've been watching it back and we're just like, oh my God, they cut out this bit, they cut out that bit. But we understand why, is because, you know, they got to include everybody. But there were some parts where we were just like, if this got aired, it would have finished everybody. Because you can imagine the jokes that me and Mo...
I'm telling you. I look at myself on my couch when I'm social commentating against these shows on the team, and I think, if ever anyone recorded this, so I could only imagine what you two get up to.
I'm telling you, we had the director, we had all the sound crew, everybody, like, in stitches. So yeah, some really, really like lovely moments, just like, you know, obviously not aired, but yeah, some really, really nice moments. Oh, this is another highlight. Off the back of Gogglebox, I was selected to represent the cast and crew at this year's BAFTAs.
We didn't win,
but just being asked by Channel 4 and by Studio Lambeth, will you accept the award on our behalf if we win? Oh man, like the BAFTAs,
I bet you. So he was all there suited and booted, all nice.
Well, it was different. It was via Zoom this year.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
it was via Zoom. So we didn't win, but trust me, we were ready. But Mo won. Mo won, he got his BAFTA, so it's still a win for us.
Someone in the camp won, so it's all good. This is definitely like the beginning in terms of like the whole TV career, I'm sure. Because I mean, I know you were on Don't Hate the Player as well. That looks like fun, that show.
It is. It is definitely fun. Unfortunately, this year there was like a lack of a crowd. So it was fun, but I can definitely tell, like, once the crowd are allowed back into like venues and stuff, it definitely will be a better show. But it was still a lot of fun. Plus, I've known Maya Jama for years. Before Fame and everything. So it was nice to reconnect back with her, because I've not seen her in ages. So
what's the kind of next steps for you?
I think the next step for me definitely is showcasing to like the nation just how funny I am in terms of stand-up. So I am currently writing a new act, trying to prepare, you know, an hour special. there's one particular TV idea that's in the workings with a production company at the moment. There's no guarantees that it will reach TV, but the conversations are nice at the moment. And that's with a good friend, Eddie Caddy. So hopefully you'll see me and Eddie Caddy on the TV screens very, very soon. Had a conversation with, do you know Javon Prince?
I don't know him personally, but I know he was in Phone Shop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I've known him for, me and that guy, I've known him for years, you know, from theatre, doing theatre back in the day. Mm-hmm. And so me and him, we are discussing a particular idea. I can't say too much.
Of course.
But talking about an idea for myself, in which he wants to definitely help me with.
Good.
So I think within a year to 2 years, you know, people should see something of my own.
Nice, yeah.
Yeah, but I still got Mo's tour to do next year, so they'll see me doing that. But in the midst of all of that, yeah, we're developing, like, you know, Babatunde's own thing.
It's only right. I'm looking forward to seeing how that all unfolds, definitely.
Same, yeah.
Imagine 10 years from now.
Oh, yeah, that's the exciting thing. It's just like, yeah, 10 years from now, what am I going to be doing? Because I wouldn't have pictured myself in even in this position, wow, like 5 years ago, wouldn't have. So to kind of like be sitting here on the kind of like on the brink of something nice happening, it's a lovely feeling, because I've been in this game for since a teenager.
Deserved. It's deserved, right?
I've definitely worked for it. But again, like I was saying, like, I've been in the game since I was 17 years old. I've been doing stand-up since that. So, you know, and I'm 34 now, you know. So
that's a while.
It's been a long time. It's been a long time.
You know what they say overnight success does not happen overnight.
Yeah.
It looks that way, but it never goes that way.
Yeah, never goes. And you never know what's going to be the thing that launches you.
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't have thought Gogglebox would have been the thing that opened the doors, but it did. But at the same time, it wasn't, what's so humbling about it is because it wasn't on my own terms.
Right.
You know, Mo was the one that said, hey, let Babatunde do the tour with me. And then off the back of the tour, because what it was supposed to be was, it was supposed to be a lead up to the tour.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, Mo and Babatunde, they're going on tour together, but it was supposed to be like, let's put them on Gogglebox. So when people come to the tour, they'll go, oh, yeah, they'll be like, oh, that's Babatunde, he was on the couch with Mo. So it was just supposed to be a nice lead up to that. But then COVID happened,
mm-hmm,
and it was just like, well, we can't do the tour right now, but you can still do Gogglebox. And it was just, all right. And then off the back of that, it's just opened so many doors. So
it's amazing. Yeah. Okay, so in terms of, like, obviously you are a Black man, a proud, mm-hmm, Black man. Do you kind of buy into this kind of idea that there are stereotypes and certain stereotypes kind of win? Or do you think it's more a case of, you know what, if you've got what it takes, it doesn't really matter how you look, it's going to work for you?
Because I've worked in the corporate world, I'll definitely say that there is a certain type that they go for.
Hmm.
And that's unfortunate. I remember when I first started, because I used to work at TFL, but I used to work in the offices.
Right.
So I remember when I first went there, a lot of the guys who were like the road kind of type or a little bit street, all of us, we stayed in the same place. None of us ever progressed, moved up to band two or any, none of that. We stayed in the same place. And it's only until someone would kind of like overlook that image, that stereotype, did any of us ever move up. I remember one of my friends, it took him 8 years just to be a manager at TFL. And by the time he got there, he was just like, this is nonsense. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like, so yeah, there definitely is a type that they go for, because all the guys that came in there and they were, you know, what some people would call bounties, or, you know what I'm kind of thing. Those were the guys that just shifted all the way up. You know what I'm saying? But hey, they're still Black, so I don't even look at things like that.
Have you ever felt like any kind of pressure yourself to conform in any way? Especially if you've been in the corporate world, yeah?
Yeah, not just in the corporate world. Even when I was at drama school, I felt like I had to act like I was a white guy in order to, you know, be accepted, because it's like they were just afraid of anything street. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, I felt that pressure.
So to understand from a young age, okay, this is what I kind of need to do in order to be accepted. Like, how did you arrive at that? You know, how did you decide this is what I got to do?
I mean, I never conformed, but in terms of thinking that mm-hmm. way, it was like, this is the only way that they're going to accept me is if I start acting like this. Because, I mean, I got critiques off of everything. When I was in drama schools, the way I dress, the way I talk, you know, the way I pronounce things, oh, you're from Tottenham, you're, you know, they critiqued everything. I remember all I said to a teacher, like, she was just like, oh, introduce yourself, just say your name. And I said, oh, yeah, you know, my name's Babatunde. And immediately she's like, oh, sorry, where are you from? I hear an accent. And I'm like, I'm from London.
You don't hear an accent. You don't hear an accent. Don't try it.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking, I'm from London. We talk about accents. I'm like, oh, no. I thought I heard an accent. Like, what's your background? I'm like, well, I'm Nigerian, but I'm born in UK.
Yeah.
But she probably just like, you know.
What it is she heard the name. She heard it. And she tried to get cute with herself. But she went, you didn't hear an accent at all. You know something? I remember like being in school. I remember like people that had like African names. It was always like, oh, do you mind if I can abbreviate? You know, no, you can't abbreviate. This is my name. If I choose to abbreviate it, then fine. I always thought that was really fresh because I don't see people having an issue like with a Welsh name. And let's be real, like Welsh names, you've got like two L's going on and that's a C. Like, you know what I mean? So you're getting confused with a name that actually runs grammatically correct, you know, in English language, like it works grammatically. You just got to spell it out. But you can work with the Gaelic. No, come on. It's,
yeah, facts.
There's this underlying kind of, it's almost like it's done without intention.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like you're questioning me about an accent when you know fully well there ain't no accent going on.
But can I tell you something? That was the beginning of a decline in my mental in terms of like the way I viewed myself, the way I viewed life. Because before then you could not chat to me. In terms of my confidence was through the roof. You know, I really believed in my talent and who I was. And that's because that was supported within the community that I came from. You know, Tottenham's a very multicultural area.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of Africans, there's a lot of Caribbeans. So even though, you know, you'd get teased about your name, you knew it just came from like a place of, it was almost like affection. It was just, Babatunde. But you know what I'm saying? It's just, but we have an understanding. You know what I'm saying? But whereas when I went to drama school, Lord, you're seeing people struggle just to say Babatunde. And I'm there, I'm saying it to them, Babatunde. And they're sweating buckets. And say, sorry, mate, can I just call you Baba? And
it's like, you cannot. I hope you told them every time, no, my name is Babatunde.
I allowed it. But I'll show you this. When I moved to the mainstream comedy circuit, my manager, she's white. And she wasn't having it. She was just like, what's your surname? I was like, Aléshé. She was just like, okay, so we're going to take away the Babatunde and it's going to be Babatunde Aléshé. That's your comedy name. Yeah. And I was like, I don't know, because, you know, they find it hard to pronounce Babatunde anyway.
Got out there with the last bit. Do you know what I mean?
My manager went crazy. She was like, hold on a minute. What's your name? I'm like, Babatunde Aléshé. She's like, that's going to be your comedy name. I was like, what?
I like your manager. I like her.
I love her. She's fantastic. But it's like, she's like, I don't care if your name is difficult. If they can pronounce Ramesh Ranganathan, they're going to pronounce Babatunde Aléshé.
Okay. They're going to do it. And this is the thing, but I feel like as Black people, really important point, as Black people, we almost accept when our culture gets watered down. It's like, we kind of say, okay, you know what, just to pacify the situation. And I'm like, no, you tell them what your name is. Like, you make them say your full name. Like, even but for real, because if we choose to abbreviate it or to shorten it, that's our prerogative. Even down to things like, I remember someone saying to me, why do Black people do this noise? I I was like, well, first of all, what's that?
Yeah, what is that that you just did?
It's not like you've got something stuck in the front of your teeth. Oh, no, you know, you do. And this wasn't like a kid or anything like that. It was a grown woman. So, like, oh, yeah, you're not, you know, you do this. And the you lot, even though it's not necessarily out and out racist, the undertone is like, you can't see what you're saying is wrong because you're so used to just having these kind of racist ideologies without being racist per se.
Can I show you? See, when I worked at TFL, I remember once I was reading, because I dealt with complaints. So I'm reading a complaint and I've sucked my teeth. I'm just like, get out of here.
As you do.
Yeah. One of the performance managers heard me and then she went and complained to my team manager. She said, he can't do that. That's rude, blah, blah, blah. So my manager's told me and I'm just like, huh? And I couldn't comprehend what he was saying because I'm thinking, what, sucking my teeth? He was just like, yeah, apparently you're not allowed to do it. I'm like, that's the same as when white people tucked.
Yeah.
It's the exact same. And I'm thinking, just because you can't suck your teeth.
You can't do it.
Yeah, just because you can't do it doesn't mean that I'm not allowed to do it. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not going to go around going, I can't tuck. I can't do that. But I can suck my teeth. So, yeah.
It's crazy. It's true. I remember in school being told that kissing your teeth is rude. But then at the time, I took that as, okay, well, tutting is rude in a sense that, you know, if a teacher's talking to you and you after them, that would be just as rude.
That's what I was about to say. In context, you can suck your teeth and it could be disrespectful.
Very rude. Yeah.
But if you're doing it as a reaction to something, it's not rude, man.
Don't tell me nothing. it's mad, isn't it? And don't you see, like, how problematic that is? Like, those people that kind of think it's okay to talk like that and to draw black people out, can't you see the problem with what's happening? Instead of trying to understand, okay, oh, that was a funny sound, oh, what does that mean, you know? Even if you have to do that just to gain and understand, don't just zoom in and presume and decide, well, oh no, that's not in line with your whiteness, so we don't like it because we feel uncomfortable. And that's what happens when it comes down to appearance as well we're talking about black men. With black men, you know, if you appear to be, I don't know, you've got a little bit of an edge to you, you know, you could be seen as maybe a bit of a rude boy, you know, then you're sort of a threat and, you know, you kind of put on the back burner. But as you said before, if you kind of fit into that, like, quote unquote, bounty look, which is a horrible term, but it is a term that is used. You're more palatable. It's like, okay, well, you're not as, you know, you're not really black because, you know, you think you're white kind of thing, you know?
I have a friend who changed his Nigerian name to a English name. He legally changed it. So it was Shenny before, but because he grew up in an area where white people could not say the name, he legally changed it to Shane. Yeah. And not only that, when we have conversations, we're from two totally different like upbringings. So obviously I grew up in the thick of it. I grew up in Tottenham, in the thick of a whole bunch of madness. He grew up in like West London and it was, you know, he went to like private school, blah, 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 blah. Cool. So when he talks about like blackness and blackness from like my kind of perspective, he totally dismisses it. He's just like, I don't know why they dress like that and da da this and da da da. But he's palatable for like white people. He's got glasses, you know, he's tall, wears suits all the time. So it's funny how me and him are like friends. Like, we laugh and joke all the time, but we're polar opposites, you know? So when we have debates, it's literally what you're saying. He is that model type for white people to go, oh, we can take him, he's fine. Shane, your name is Shane? Oh, fantastic.
Okay, that's fine, yes. Shane's an Irish name, do you know what I mean? Yeah, or something. Oh.
Yeah, but someone like me, oh my God. When I went to drama school, like I said before, the minute I walked in there, they were just like, what? And I was the only black guy.
Really?
The only black person, not just guy, the only black person in my class.
Hmm.
So a group of 30 students, and it's just me, the one person that was black. So, oh man, I went through hell.
So you were already on the radar.
Just anything I did, it didn't matter. I remember the first time I read they made me read like a monologue. And imagine, they've just given me the book. Here you go, read that monologue. So I've stood up, I've read it, but I don't know what this is about. So I've just read it. And then the woman, she just looked at me, she was like, well, you read it well, but I didn't get anything from that. And I just went, all right. I just sat down. Because I'm thinking, well, what do you just gave me the book.
Exactly, a little bit directional stomach, do you know what I mean? I could, what the?
Yeah, everything was screwing up.
Yeah, that's deep. Yeah. But at least you kind of came through. So you stuck out the whole drama school. You did. So you finished it, right? You went through and did the whole thing. So I bet that, well, that must have hushed a few lips up, put it that way.
Yeah, definitely one teacher who was gunning for my head in the first year. That definitely would have hushed him up.
It'd be interesting to see how they would react to you now.
Yeah, it would be. Mm. It would be. It would be.
But of course, we don't do things for that reason. But it's nice. It's nice to know that, you know, you it's almost like you're written off. And I think a lot of Black guys do get written off. You know, just going back to what you were saying about your friend Shane, you know, I don't understand. Don't get me wrong. There is nothing wrong with, you know, being that kind of, you know, the glasses, the suit. And if that's what you like, because some people just genuinely like that look, that's fine. You know, you don't have to fit into this kind of stereotypical bubble of what a Black man should be. But it's when you want to argue the toss and act like, you know, it's you versus other Black people. Like, I don't understand why you can't see you're an idiot. You know, no disrespect to your friend. No,
I thought you had to pick your words carefully there.
Yeah, I did. No disrespect, but I mean, like, it's idiotic behavior because you're still Black. And even though you're kikiing with your people in the office, believe me, when they have something to say about you, the first thing they're drawing for, you know, that Black coon, you know, you're still Black to them. So whilst I don't think you should compromise who you are, I think you should know who you are. And if you're Black, you have to embrace that regardless of what you like to wear and how you like to talk. You're still essentially Black. And if everybody else can see it, you need to see it too. Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. But let me put my soapbox away. Jesus. Kind of like sticking with appearance, I guess, like a massive stereotype that I've found, and a lot of the stuff that I do with like sex and wellness, this stereotype of Black men being like over-sexualized, insatiable, freaky dudes with massive, you know, penises.
I mean, there's some truth.
There's something in there.
Me, definitely. I mean, look, I'm a married man, but I'm definitely, I like sex.
But is it because you're Black, though?
I don't think it's got nothing to do with my Blackness. That's men. Yo, there are some. When you start hearing stories, especially within the industry, when you start hearing stories about some of the stuff some people get up to, you're like, what?
Really?
Like, I like sex, but whoa.
Yeah, some freaky behavior. Yeah.
So I don't think it's got nothing to do with being.
But do you not feel that, like, sometimes when, especially, like, if you've been propositioned by a woman that might be outside, I know you're married, so obviously with all due respect, but, you know, you might have found you've been hit on by a woman that's not Black. Do you feel that her ideas of what you're going to be are already made up because you're Black? Like, automatically you've got a monster in your pants.
Oh, yeah. That's when you dig deep and you get to the root cause of why some of them, not all, but some of them, especially the ones that are not in tune with our culture, it's because of that reason.
Yeah.
They want to see it. They want to see what's happening.
Because it's gonna look, because like your penis is gonna look different. I mean, apart from the fact that it's a different color, it's just gonna be something different. It's gonna have a face or something. Yeah. It's gonna have muscles and that, you know, it's gonna come out and be like, rah.
Yeah, that's what they believe, boy. They think that all of us are just packing some machine guns down there. And it's just like,
okay. And let's be real, there are some Black men that have small peens as well, and there's some with large ones, and it's not.
I mean, I don't be looking, but
I know
it is what it is. Like, you know, I've been in the changing room with other guys, and it's just like, sorry, bro. You're gonna be you're gonna struggle for a bit, you know what I'm saying? You just work on your personality.
Oh no, you don't say that. You've never said that.
Of course I don't say that, but it's
just, you imagine.
But you know what it is? I just see it as, well, it is what it is. Because there's this thing as well, like you're either a grower or a shower. So right. There's that. You gotta take that into account. So a man could be undressed and then it's like, rah, my brother. But then when in his time, when he's with his woman and he gets aroused, it's mad.
Yeah, it's all mad.
It's what it is, boy. Just work with it.
and also, you've got to take into account that sometimes girth, some women prefer girth over length anyway. So I think it's not, you can't necessarily say because someone might have a smaller in length that they're going to be lacking. And also, it's what you kind of do around that. Because if we want to get technical, penetration only serves part of the purpose. Do you know what I'm saying?
That's exactly it. Because again, in my experience, it's cool. All right. You're the way you are. Mm-hmm. But that's just 50%, if that, what you need to be doing. And you learn as you get older and as you have, you know, more experiences, you start learning, okay, well, let me do this, let me do that. And da-da-da. And that doesn't always involve the thing down there.
Exactly.
You learn, you listen and you respond. And it's the same with when women do what they do to you. They take feedback and do it like this. And obviously it's all within the moment.
Of course, yeah.
But you get what I'm saying.
I totally get what you're saying. Do you think that black men are fetishized?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But do you think it kind of works in their favor? Because as you said, like at the beginning, well, when I mentioned the whole black men and sexual stereotypes, you said, yeah, a lot of it's true. So do you think it kind of works like for black guys to know that they're looked at as having like a bedroom bully?
Yeah, it does. It does. I think sisters know the truth. Mm. You know, sisters know the truth, but the stereotype is still out there amongst, you know, people outside of our race. But like yourself, you know what's going on with black guys. not like that. But what I'm saying is, you know, not all black guys are out there.
No, of course not. Yeah. But when does it start becoming a problem, though, these stereotypes? You know, because, okay, we can enjoy the fact that you might be seen as having a big schlong when you've actually got a maggot, or you could be seen as having like stamina for days when really you can only last 5 minutes. You know, that's cool and good. But when does that become a problem?
I think the problem comes when it's things like within films. So like, mm-hmm. I remember you've posted a lot of things, you know, of that film Mandingo, and, you know, even within like the porn industry, there's like a whole interracial category dedicated to black men tearing white women apart.
Literally tearing, like ripping and piecing back together, Babatunde.
But what they don't understand is that those, as much as the guys are holding what they've got, it's not natural. Them guys, it's not natural. So yeah, their thing might look like this when they take it out, but but it's not natural, you know what I'm saying? They might have surgery and all of that kind of stuff. But that still feeds, into the stereotype that all black guys are like this.
Yeah.
And I think that's the problem, because then we start to look at ourselves like, especially if you're someone who watches porn, you're looking at that and you're looking at your thing and you're going, rah, what's...
There's something, it's not connected. Yeah.
That's where it becomes a problem.
You know what, I 1000% agree. Porn is definitely one of the biggest perpetuators of the sexual stereotype and fetishization of black men, 100%. But even things like cuckold porn, you know, that's often with black men and, you know, white women and their white husband or partners in the corner looking on, you know, just to
For the reasons I just don't watch it for stuff, stupidness like that and all that nasty bondage stuff. I can't get down with it.
There is ethical porn. We're not trying to make this about sex, but there is ethical porn, which is a bit more, if you're someone that doesn't like all that stuff, because I do think more people are sort of turning away from like the porn hubs and the kind of, you know, the X videos and stuff like that, because it literally is what?
It messes with your mental.
It does. But if you do want to enjoy kind of sensuality, let's say, ethical porn. Yeah. I'm really trying to promote it. Ethical porn is that it's more couples. So it'd be like realistic people you could probably relate to and imagine yourself and like your wife in that situation a lot easier than some of these flipping hardcore laying down kind of beat up that no one in their right mind is trying to, like, a woman is not gonna, come on, even a dude is not gonna be able to sustain that. These porn stars prep.
Yeah, you
know, prep is so deep. People don't get that. Even like squirting and stuff, like, no one squirts fountains like that. You know what I mean? Come on, they've got packs of like fluid up there that literally pop and psh, you know, all of this kind of stuff. But we're digressing massively. But have you ever been in a situation like maybe in the industry, obviously, where you've been around people and you feel like you've been fetishized?
Not around people, but definitely in the DMs now. Mm-hmm. You know, you get that. I just don't even, I don't answer them. I don't look at them. Oh yeah, 100%. Yeah. I save them just to show my wife, look at this stupidness, and then delete. Like even just, the other, was it yesterday? Yeah, yesterday. Someone added me, but I think someone's added me, I've gone to look at their page and I'm thinking, who is this person? So I've looked at their story, and obviously in their story, the girl's all this doing all this nonsense. So I've come off, but obviously they must have seen that I've seen the story. So then they've sent me a DM saying hello. And I just didn't answer it because I'm thinking, chill. Just like, yeah, relax. It's not that, you know. But obviously it's gone through to my request. So I just deleted it. So they didn't even see that I saw that. But it's just like, it's stuff like that just irks me. It's just like,
I guess people try and shoot their shot. I guess it's for men to kind of put these people in their place. And like what you're saying, you just delete. Like, I'm not interested.
You can see it all over my page. Married man. Mm. I ain't got time.
The thing is, Babatunde, that's the thing.
Yeah, what I've learned.
And also, again, it's that thing, isn't it? As a black man, so what, you're married? That don't mean you ain't cheating. You know, people have that idea that black men cheat.
Especially Nigerian.
Well, Nigerian and Jamaican, because let's be real, Nigerian and Jamaican men are one in the same.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're literally cut from the same cloth.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, there is that, you know, and that's unfair. So you will get people that are disrespectful that will still try and kind of step into your marriage almost and try and lure you away from your wife and do all these kind of, and I think that the higher up you kind of go and the more immersed in the industry you get, oh geez.
Oh yeah!
Imagine.
Yeah, I can imagine it will just get worse. I can't imagine that. I don't pay attention to any of this.
Yeah. All right. Just moving away from sort of sexual stereotype. Mental health is a massive thing amongst Black people. I think mental health is a massive thing anyway. In general, we're talking about it more as a society. We're understanding the importance of mental health. You know, it's just as equally as important as physical health. But Black men are actually more susceptible to mental health issues. That's a fact. From the age of, I think, is it 11? I want to say 11. From a very young age, it's been like stats show us that Black boys stroke Black men start developing mental health issues. As a Black man, how do you kind of keep yourself mentally kind of aligned, you know?
Well, now I listen to a lot of audio tapes, a lot of audio books. So today, and yeah, recently I've been listening to The Imposter Cure.
Okay.
One of my friends, a good friend of mine, Imhotep, when we talk a lot, and during the conversation, he was just like, oh my God, you got imposter syndrome. I'm like, imposter syndrome? What the hell is that? He's like, you got imposter syndrome, bro. So I've looked into it myself and I was like, damn, I've got imposter syndrome. You know what I'm saying? And so... obviously, I've got all the Audible, the Amazon thing. So I've downloaded that book, The Imposter Cure, and I've been listening to that. And that's a very, very good book. So that's how I keep on top of my mental health, is seeing the signs, recognizing them, and then making sure that every day I listen to some type of motivational tape for the first hour. Like as soon as I wake up, I don't go on my phone, but I go on my phone to just play the actual tape, and I just listen to that. So, you know, that's the first thing I'm hearing for an hour when I wake up. I go on walks. Luckily, I live in the country now. So, because I live in Hertfordshire, there's this open fields and, you know, lakes and all that lovely stuff. So I go on walks, make sure I'm getting like my vitamin D and fresh air and all that stuff. But I also listen to tapes while I'm walking. All sounds corny, but you know what?
It doesn't sound corny.
It doesn't, but I'm talking about me and my, like, from my background. Me, 15 years ago, I wouldn't have done none of this, but I would have definitely needed this, especially when I was in drama school. I would have needed what I'm doing now for sure, because it's sad. And this broke my heart the day this happened. But I think middle of this year, my best friend, who is like my brother, had a mental breakdown. God. And I'm on the phone with him because his woman called me. And I can hear him in the background. He's losing it. Like, he's actually on the brink of losing it. And I could hear him. And I'm like, that's not my best friend. Like, this doesn't sound like him. Eventually, when me and him were able to talk, he's calmed down. He's, you know, we've gone back and forth, me shouting at him and, you know, trying to basically get him to calm down. By the time we've had a conversation, I'm like, wow, like, he's someone, he's not involved in the industry. He's not no bad boy. He's not, you know, he's not a bad guy at all. He's not no roadman. But just the pressures of life, you know, it just got to him so much that he nearly flipped. Like, I've never heard him like this. Like, he was on the road screaming, like, he was going mad. And I remember just telling him, like, what's kept me sane and what's kept me on top of, like, all of that is the books that I'm listening to, making sure that I listen to motivational tapes, making sure that I'm dealing with the problems that I've got, not drinking, because if you're drinking on a daily basis, you're suppressing, you know, whatever thoughts and feelings you've got, and you're only just feeding yourself, like, you know, trying to gratify yourself, mm-hmm. you know, your own self. So that's why I say, even with porn, it's a thing of, it's a mental killer, because you are just trying to please yourself. You're trying to gratify. It's easy gratification. You're just trying to make yourself feel good because you don't want to deal with a particular thing. And it's the same with alcohol. I drink alcohol, but you got to control it and stay on top of it, because you don't want to just always reach for that bottle to make yourself feel good. You actually have to deal with the issues that you've got.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. And so I make sure that I talk to certain people that I've got in my life that I talk to, and I talk to them. I make sure this conversation is about getting all the trash out of my mind. And not to put my trust on you, but I just need to,
Yeah.
Ori Styler is one of the people that I talk to. Like, me and Ori, we talk.
That's me good. And Ori,
yeah, we talk. Him, you know, he does it to me, I do it to him. We talk.
That's so good. So it is. You have someone that's on your level as well, because, like, I mean, I'm an advocate for therapy. I think everybody should kind of see, you know, talking therapies, whatever, to download. But I also think it's good if you have, like we were saying, like you've got Ori, someone that's like a peer to you, because they can relate easier. Like, a therapist is just there to listen, you know, you just talk. Someone that can relate, you know, you can kind of work through stuff as well. So that's so important.
Yeah, so, and we encourage each other as well. Like, we don't just talk and, like, allow each other just to kind of get all the rubbish off our chest, but we, you know, we pull each other up. Come on, work harder, man. Do this. I need to see you doing this. Da, da, da. Even Eddie Caddy, you know, he's got some good news coming very, very soon. But I remember I phoned him and I kind of had a go at him. I was just like, I need to see you back where we know you're supposed to be. You know, you're Eddie Caddy. And I went I went in on him, and I was just like, there's a situation that I want you to kind of, like, entertain, because you need to be at that point. And for like a month straight, I was just hounding him, harassing him. I need to see you back here. And then, that's why I say he's got good news coming, because he finally turned around and was just like, Baba, thank you, you know, for giving, even though he was in a good place mentally, I was just like,
hear it.
Yeah, you need to hear this. And yeah.
Sometimes you need to hear it again from your peers.
Oh yeah.
Rings at home. It's like there's something more true about it coming from someone that you know loves you as a brother, has your best interest at heart.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. But if outside of that, like just like I'm saying, me personally, I just make sure I always make a point to listen to stuff that's reinforcing that message, that positive message within my mind, of whether it's how good or my potential where I could reach to, and staying on top of my craft as well. That's another thing, because if you're a singer, you need to stay on top of your craft. So as a comedian, what reinforces the message of me being funny, because you can imagine being funny or having the thought of I'm a funny guy, that is pressure within itself.
Yeah, it must be tiring sometimes. Yeah.
You get what I'm trying to say? But you got to keep on top of that, because there's days where you don't feel funny. And you got to keep, like, for all comics, you have to keep on top of that. But the key to keeping on top of that is learning your craft, even though you know your craft. Keep learning your craft. So even if it's going over the foundation and the basics, just learn. Just listen and learn. Don't forget it, because even on days where you don't feel funny, you know you can always go back to that foundation. Oh, okay, well, I don't feel good, but I'm on stage, so hey, set up punchline, callback, rule of three, you just know how to do it automatically. Yeah. Yeah, and that reinforces that message that I don't have to feel good, but I'm still a good performer or whatever. So yeah.
You do what you gotta do. I love that, and I love your honesty, Babatunde, because I think this is kind of what we need, honesty. All what you're saying, these are all like real situations, you know. Some days aren't good. Some days you just feel like, I just want to lie in my bed and do nothing, you know, but you know you've got to get up and do life. And that's okay, as long as you can kind of keep a lid on stuff. And you mentioned, you know, 15 years ago, you know, coming from your background, you know, Tottenham growing up in the ends or whatever, you know, you probably wouldn't have entertained this lifestyle that you now have in Hertfordshire. Do you think that's, well, I think I know the answer to this, but do you think that's a massive issue for why we have so many mental health issues with, let's say, for want of a better expression, kind of like inner city black people? I mean, I hate that term, but you know what I'm trying to say, like people that have grown up sort of in the city, you know, away from like the air and the fresh air and the roaming fields and the, you know, even like a sheep or two on the hillside, you know what I mean?
I don't think it's just, you know, the physical environment. I think it's the thing of, you got to have wake-up calls, man. My first wake-up call from, because I was ignorant when I was young. I was ignorant as hell. Like, I could have gone down that road of the whole rude boy thing, but it was just like, once you see someone get stabbed, you're like, nah, not for me. You know what I'm saying? But my first wake-up call was when I became a Christian. Because before then, I was ignorant as hell. I spoke. The way I would speak to girls was crazy. It's just like, I was just like, I look back at that and I'm just like, you thought you could have got girls talking like that? Yeah, you're all right.
That was you, that's where you was mentally, isn't it?
Mentally, you couldn't, that's what I'm saying, you couldn't chat to me. Like, I was rude as hell, because I knew I had my boys backing me, but I was obnoxious, I was just ignorant. The way Christianity came into my life was just, it was just out of the blue, and it's not like God had to hit me over the head, it was just the message of, you know, Jesus Christ just touched me home, but it's almost like an explosion went off. It was just like, oh, snap.
Everything made sense.
Yeah, it was like, bro, I've been acting like a donut out here. I've been living like an idiot. Mm. And that was my first wake-up call. And then my second wake-up call, I know I've said it before, but it was going to drama school, because it was just like, not everybody sees you the way you see yourself. You were comfortable in Tottenham because you're surrounded by people that look like you. Now you are the only black person. How does it feel? Mm-hmm. It didn't feel nice because of the way people were reacting to me. So that was another wake up call, is not everybody likes you. So learn that. And then now that I'm a husband and a father and, you know, getting older, it's like, you've got to take care of here first. Absolutely. Mentally, you've got to be capable, able to deal with the needs of your wife, the needs of your child, family, friends, loved ones. You got to stay. So don't just go to the gym to exercise physically, but you've got to read books. You've got to listen to stuff to exercise your brain, your mind, how you feel about yourself. That is a huge key.
Yes to all of that. 100%, seriously, preach, because it's so true. And it's amazing to hear, obviously you've got a young boy, you know, he's going to grow up and he's going to have his own issues and trials and tribulations along the way. And provided you are kind of stable in where you're at mentally and you understand the importance, and this kind of goes for everyone, like as long as we understand what it is and the importance of maintaining that mental health, I feel like you're going to have a nation of stable Black boys or stable Black people if we understand the importance of maintaining the mental health. Like, not waiting for it to get to boiling point before we're like, oh shit, he's in the hospital because he's had a mental breakdown, or, you know, sadly, he's, you know, tried to top himself. You know, people, you know, this is what people do. So I think it's so, so important. It couldn't be more important.
It's very important.
To focus on mental health the same way we look at physical health.
Yeah.
Because actually, if you check it, like, if your mental health ain't there, your physical health is going to go down the cars anyway.
Exactly. And one of the benefits to working on your mental health is, I remember before I used to wake up, I'd have like negative thoughts, like someone will say something negative about me and I believe it. I'd be like, oh man, I am this way or I am that way. But when I started working on up here, I would wake up expecting something good to happen. Wow. That was the difference.
Yeah.
And that was a great feeling. And I wanted to wake up. I'd wake up and I'd be like, I feel like I'm going to get good news today. And I love that feeling. And I wake up with that all the time. And it's just like, I want to have that feeling all the time. I don't want to wake up thinking fearful thoughts and all types of things.
Babatunde, thank you so much, honestly. Thank you so much for your time, your honesty, your everything. Like, I just feel like there's so much there that I think a lot of people can take away from, especially around the mental health. We need to have more Black men of note talk about these things and let these young guys especially know that it's okay to not be okay and deal with that. Don't sit on it. Don't make it a problem. Don't let it become a bigger issue. Because once you're in that system as well, they've written you off. And from the time your skin's Black and they're calling you mental, you ain't got a hope in hell, you know?
Absolutely.
And that's the harsh reality of it. So Babatunde, thank you. Wishing you all the success.
Thank you.
All the luck, all the joy, all the happiness, all the contentment, all the warmth, all the fresh air, all everything. Thank you so much.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Take care.